Hello everyone, and welcome back to our Decifrix Trend, Trends in Modern Cryptography. I am Andrea Visconti, I'm a professor of University of Milan, and this afternoon we will talk about lattice attacks on NTRU. On this webinar, we will focus on lattice attacks, and we try to understand how the attack works. In particular, we will use a toy example to explain NTRU encryption phase and decryption phase. And then, using the same example, we play with our attack. Notice that the polynomials involved in this attack are for a reduced size. So our computation can be also executed by hand. Finally, we will try to understand why, although this attack has been published in literature, NTRU is still secure. Okay, before describing our attack on NTRU, we briefly recap all the parameters involved in the decryption and encryption phases. Let's start with the parameters. We have three parameters here, N, P, and Q, such that the greatest common divisor between P and Q is equal to 1, and Q is greater than P. Then we have to define R in this way. Z join X, quotient with X to the power of N minus 1. Then we have to define the message, that is also the message is a polynomial, M of X, and the coefficients of these polynomials are between minus P minus 1 half and P minus 1 half. Then we have to choose a couple of polynomials, two random polynomials, F and G, F of X and G of X, such that we are able to compute the inverse of F. And in particular, we use the capital letters FP and FQ to identify the inverse of F modulo P and modulo Q respectively. Then we have to define a private key and a public key. In particular, H is a polynomial again, is a our public key, and we are able to compute our public key multiplying the inverse of F modulo Q times the random polynomial G. This is our public key, H, and then we have to choose our private key. The private key is composed of a couple of parameters in this case, F of P and F, but also the random polynomial G is a secret parameter. So in the sequel of our webinar, we will use the red notation to identify the private keys, and in green, we will identify the public information, while in light blue, we will identify our message. Now that we have understood how to encrypt and decrypt our messages, we will try to understand the details of the attack. The main idea of this attack is to find a lattice where we can find a shorter vector, and we can find this shorter vector with high probability. So this vector is not the only one that can be used to decrypt our messages. There are also other vectors that can be used to decrypt the messages. Also, all these vectors are part of the lattice. We can take the equation of the public key, and then we can rewrite the equation of the public key in this way. And then if we consider a vector FG and a matrix L defined in this way, where in this corner, right upper corner, we can find the coefficients of our public key. In the first row of this upper right corner, we can find the coefficients of A of the polynomial H, and then in the second row we can find the same coefficients rotated right by one step. The same operation is repeated several times till the first coefficient H0 is placed. We can find the coefficient of H0 in the last position here. So if we take this matrix L, we can associate the public key H to the lattice span by our matrix L. So now we can rewrite again the equation 1 as follows, using a suitable polynomial U of X, and then with this polynomial U and our public key F, we are able to show that this vector is in lattice L. In particular, we multiply the polynomial FU times our matrix L, and then we will see that we are able to compute exactly this polynomial that this vector is a vector in the lattice. So since we know F and G, we are able to compute the exact norm of F of this vector, but an attacker don't know our private key, so he can use heuristic, or we can use heuristic to predict the length of the shorter vector. Now let's suppose that the vector F first G first is a short vector for the lattice. So from the equation one, we can write G first equal to F first time H modulo Q. So using this vector, we are able to decrypt our message. More precisely, we multiply F first times C, that is our ciphertext. And then we compute all the stuff here, and we are able to show that the result of this operation is the polynomial A of X. The coefficient of these polynomials are between minus Q half and Q half. So we can try to retrieve the original message M of X by multiplying for the inverse of F first modulo P. This means that our vector F first G first is short enough. Again, applying the decryption procedure and multiplying F first time M, we are able to retrieve the original message M. On the contrary, if such a vector is not short enough, some values of A of X may not be between minus Q half and Q half. So this means that we are not able to decrypt our message, but if some coefficients are in the interval, we can use other vectors, f second and g seconds, and sometimes it is possible to recover the original message. In this example, we have defined all the parameters n, p, and q. 11, 3, and 61. Then we choose the two random polynomials f and g in this way. And then we compute the inverse of f modulo p and modulo q, respectively. After that, we can compute our public key h. And then using our public key H and our private key FP and F, we are able to encrypt and decrypt our messages. So let's choose a random message. This is our random message, and this is also a random polynomial for the encryption. We are able to compute our ciphertext in this way, multiplying p times phi times our public key h, and then we have to add our message m modulo q. If you execute this computation using these polynomials, we get exactly this result, this polynomial. For the decryption, we will do exactly the opposite procedure. We take the ciphertext C, we multiply C times F, and we get A, and then we centerlit A, and finally we compute A times the inverse of F modulo P. And centerlitting also this last polynomial, we are able to get the original message M. So using these polynomials, we are able to compute our message, decrypt and decrypt our message easily. Okay. Now, we'll define our matrix L, as previously mentioned. In the right upper corner, we have to add, we have to fill the first row of the right upper corner with the coefficients of our public key. Our public key is this h. So we have to add these values, 50, 5, 32, and so on. And here on the first row, you will see that we have written exactly the coefficients of our public key. Then, as previously mentioned, we have to take the first vector written in this row, and then we have to rotate this vector by one parameters, by one step right, not left, right. So the number 11 that is here, you can find it on the second row in the first position. Then we can take our vector f and g. We take the coefficients of f and the coefficient of g. And we show that the vector alpha f and g is in the lattice. So we compute this operation. We take the polynomial u of x in this way, and then we multiply f u times our matrix L. If we compute this operation, we see that the vector that we obtain is exactly fg. So now we can compute the exact norm of the vector fg, and as we can see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, the norm is the square root of 13. Okay, so, okay, now we have found the exact norm of FG. Now that we can implement an attack, for example, using a software tool. So we can generate our matrix L in this way. Our matrix L is a matrix of dimension 22 times 22. We fill our matrix as previously mentioned, and we show that a linear combination of the row of such matrix give exactly the vector fg, and this is the exactly the combination that we can use to compute f and g. So now we have to find the shortest vectors, and to do that we can use, for example, an algorithm. And applying this algorithm to the matrix previously defined, we are able to compute all the shortest vectors in the lattice. Notice that in this case, I plot here only the vectors that has norm 13, because I know what is the exactly norm. But an attacker that don't know what is the right norm can compute all the shortest vector. In this case, we are able to found three shortest vector, B2, B3, and B5, that have exactly the norm 13. If you look closely these vectors, we will see that this vector has a simple rotation of fg, or minus f and minus g. But our matrix contains also other vectors. And in particular, I found another vector that is called B0. And this vector has norm smaller than the previous vectors. In this case, this vector has norm square root of 12. And this vector is not a rotation of f and g. So We can call this vector f first and g first, and we try to decrypt our message m of x using this vector. That it is not the right vector, is not a rotation of f and g. So we take a spurious key and we try to decrypt our message using this spurious key. Again, we take our ciphertext C, we multiply this C time f first, and we get this polynomial. Modulo 61. Again, we center left A of x, modulo q, and we can check, for example, some coefficients here. 7 is okay for us because it is between minus 31 and 31. 54 is not okay. So we can move the number 54 to minus 7, and minus 7 is between minus 31 and 31. Then we can repeat the same operation also for 55, that is equivalent to minus 6. 8 is okay, minus 5 is okay, 1 is okay, 2 is okay, 58 is not, it is not. So it is equivalent to minus 3. 60 is equivalent to minus 1, modulo 61. And 58 is equivalent to minus 3, and 1 is okay. So now we have center left our polynomial A of x. Then we take this polynomial of A of x, and we have to multiply times the inverse of f modulo p. F first, not f, f first modulo p. So we compute again this operation, and we get this message. Notice that all the coefficients of this message are okay, but 2 is not between minus 1 and 1. So we have to center left again this polynomial, and 1 is okay, 2 is not okay, so it is equivalent to minus 1, and the last one is okay. So after our decryption with the spurious key, we found this message M, and it's not difficult to see that this message is exactly the previous message, that the previous polynomial M of X that we have defined in our previous slides. And we can find here. We can check that the coefficients are exactly the same. We get exactly the same polynomial, and we have not decrypted the message with our private and public key. So, okay. So why it is possible to decrypt the message with a spurious key? We are able to decrypt the message with this spurious key because the coefficient of these polynomials are between minus 31 and 31. So these polynomials are equal to the previous one C in equation 2. And the equation 2 is this equation, modulo 61. So we are able to get the same message, the same polynomial with or without our model. So if the coefficients are between minus 31 and 31, we are able to decrypt the message. If not so, that is, if these coefficients are smaller than minus 31 or are bigger than 31, so we are not able to decrypt our message. We are not able to recover our full message. And in order to show exactly this example, I take another vector, B11. This vector has a norm square root of 633. We call this vector f second and g second, and these are the two polynomials. And then we can try to use f second and g second to decrypt our message, our ciphertext C, to get our message. If we compute exactly the same procedure, we note that we are able to compute not exactly M, but another message that is called M first. And this M first is not equal to our previous message M. And now we have to understand why the decryption phase fails. The decryption fails because there are some differences between these two polynomials that are computed with the spurious key, f first, g first, and a wrong key, f second and g second. In particular, if we check these first polynomials, this one, we are able to see that something goes wrong. In particular, if we center lift this polynomial, we are able to compute this one and also this one. These polynomials, the first, where the coefficient are not in the interval minus 31 and 31, and more precisely, where the coefficients are, in this case, bigger than 31, 37 is bigger than 31, x to the power of 6 as a coefficient minus 64, that is not in the interval, but also x to the power of 5 is not in the interval, 9 is in the interval, 93 is not in the interval, and then the last one is the coefficient minus 60. So we have some issues here exactly where our coefficients are not in the interval previously defined. Notice that this polynomial is not exactly the previous polynomial, it's not exactly the polynomial that we have previously computed. In particular, we are able to decrypt the message when our polynomials are computed modulo 61 or not, provide us the same polynomial. In conclusion, we can say that although the attack has been published in literature and TRU is secure, why? The security of NTRU lies on the difficulty to find a short vector in a lattice of higher dimension than those presented in our prior example. So the attack is useful if an attacker is able to find short vectors in the lattice. But we know that this problem is an hard problem, is an NP hard problem. If we set the parameters of NTRU as large as possible. Thanks for your attention.